In this service, we commemorate the sacrifice of those who made the supreme sacrifice, fighting in all the wars and campaigns in which Rhodesia fought so gallantly over the years past. A special word of welcome to those who are joining us via YouTube. Every year, until 2019, this service was held physically here at Dickie Fritz Shell Hole in Edenvale, Johannesburg. Last year, due to COVID-19 regulations prevailing at the time, we were unable to have our usual service. But we were able to record a video service and broadcast that on YouTube. The coronavirus pandemic has persisted, as we all know, and significantly disrupted nearly all the aspects of our daily lives and our ability to work, to socialize, and participate in normal activities. The international supply chain is broken, and the impact is being felt by all here in South Africa and abroad. Most annual memorial services have been either cancelled or severely restricted. Faced with the facts that the organization of such a service is a significant logical and financial exercise, and that the risk of cancellation late in the day due to further COVID regulations remains a very real risk, your committee accordingly decided it would be prudent to make this year's service a virtual one again, with the sincere hope that next year will be better. We record our thanks to Mark Williams and Mark Klein of Mark Klein Productions for guiding us through this next edition of this project, which will again enable a much wider audience to view a typical Rhodesian Forces memorial service. We also thank the old bull of this shell hole, Leon Apicella, and his committee for their cooperation and permission to use the premises today and film, as we're doing now. Although we are able to put on the virtual service, it is regrettable that it has not been possible to have the usual parade before the start of the service. We would have up to 100 veterans, both men and women, forming up and marching on to be addressed by the reviewing officer before the service. This short march has been the highlight of these services over many years for those veterans participating. Those who have attended a number of previous services will be aware that while the essential shape of the service remains in the traditional format of a memorial service, as year succeeds year, there have been changes of participants and details. Over these years, six members of the original committee have answered the sunset call, which may make a membership of the committee something of a hazardous occupation. Time and ill health have taken its toll on others, and three founder members, Wally Ferreira, Colonel John Redfern, and Padre Billy Dodgen, would have been precluded from participating in this year's service due to these factors. So the issue of what to change and what to keep the same has posed a challenge. As you will see, we have elected to keep the detail of this service substantially unchanged as a tribute to those who've gone before us in this enterprise. We do well to sing, change and decay, in all around I see, I change, thou changest not, abide with me. The advancing years take their toll in the ranks of the regimental associations as well. And as we see obituary notices circulated on websites and newsletters, we are reminded of those we knew as young men and women, as schoolmates and brothers in arms. Change there has been, as change is the only constant in the human experience. Sonoya High School has updated their roll of honor, adding the name of Brian Brignac. The Milton and St. Stephen's rolls have had names adjusted, and Morgan High School has added their roll to the school rolls. The Dickie Fritz facilities have also expanded over the years. Services were held originally in the main hall and soon overflowed onto the upgraded veranda, then into a marquee in the car park, and finally a very big marquee in this Garden of Remembrance, to which new memorials were progressively added. The RLI Troopy, the BSAP Serviceman, the Air Force Memorial, and the Rhodesian Engineers, as well as the Lomba Guest Accommodation, all of which you will see in the background to this service. You can expect further changes when again we are able to meet physically, God willing, fresh faces, fresh detail, new features. The committee would like to take this opportunity to thank Alan Strachan and Carol Doughty for their leadership and support of these memorial services over the past 7 years. Having made the decision to emigrate to the UK, they braved the COVID quarantine and are now settled near Salisbury in Wiltshire. During these years, the memorial display has been maintained, enhanced, and kept in good order. The numbers attending the services have increased year on year, and the financial position of the committee strengthened. The memorial display today is better than it was at the first memorial service, and our financial position is such that we have been able to donate funds to the Flame Lily Foundation to help to care for Rhodesians in need. The introduction of the Rhodesian School's wreath laying section of the services has had a hugely positive impact on the success of the services over the last several years. We record our thanks to Bruno Squera for continuing to serve as the Rhodesian School's representative, although he has semigrated to a congenial coastal region of South Africa. We would also like to thank those donors who have continued to support the memorial in these times of economic stress and challenge. They know who they are, and we record a heartfelt vote of gratitude and appreciation to them for their contributions. We likewise thank the various regimental associations who have accepted and support this annual memorial service as the official Rhodesian memorial service in South Africa. In addition to those who have donated generously to the memorial fund over the years, many others have given a helping hand in setting up and packing away the memorial year by year, and others have helped out behind the scenes in other ways. It is not possible to name everyone, but they know who they are, and we record our sincere thanks and appreciation to them all. Thanks also to the many people who have regularly attended these annual memorial services for their support and making each one memorable. Please continue to attend future services when we are able to hold these again, since as long as the generous donations to the fund and the purchase of fundraising merchandise continues, the Rhodesian Forces Memorial will remain an annual event and may well continue to be the largest gathering of Rhodesians anywhere in the world. Our Rhodesian Forces Memorial is a memorial to our fallen and does not celebrate any political event. We remember that through a history fraught with wars and political turmoil, right up to 1980, when Zimbabwe gained its independence from Britain, Rhodesians answered their country's call. In so doing, Rhodesia earned herself a proud and distinguished military reputation, fighting alongside other Commonwealth countries in the Anglo-Boer War, the Great War, the Second World War, the Korean War, the Malayan Emergency, and then in the valiant years of going it alone in the face of international sanctions and isolation. In the Second World War, Rhodesia was the first country to send troops to fight alongside those of Great Britain. Of those who went to fight, only 1 out of every 10 never returned home. Despite this, Rhodesians are still not permitted to participate in the annual Remembrance Day parade and wreath-laying ceremony held at the Cenotaph in Whitehall in the UK. In 2018, as an act of reconciliation, Germany was invited to lay a wreath at the Cenotaph. It is a supreme irony that Germany be invited whilst we remain left out in the cold. those men and women who gave their lives fighting for Britain in her hour of need deserve the same recognition as their comrades from other Commonwealth countries, dominions and colonies. Calls have been made, notably by Lord Ashcroft and other leaders in the United Kingdom, but these have so far fallen on deaf ears. The politicians who have kept this policy in place should be ashamed, and we look forward to the day that this ban is reversed and these men and women will be appropriately recognized. Although this memorial service is in remembrance of all those who gave their lives fighting for Rhodesia and is dedicated to the brave men and women who lost their lives in the Rhodesian Bush War, we also remember the many civilians, men, women and children of all races, whose lives were brutally taken by a ruthless and cowardly enemy. We spare a thought for those who have been left physically or psychologically wounded, and we must not forget the terrible emptiness that families and close friends experience in the loss of loved ones. Nor should we forget those who have suffered dispossession, persecution, imprisonment and death in the years subsequent to 1980. Thank you to all of you for putting aside some of your time to watch this service today and to remember our fallen. By remembering their service and sacrifice, we recognize the worth of the freedoms that these men and women fought to preserve. At a time in history when these very freedoms are again being threatened by socialist and totalitarian regimes around the world. They gave their tomorrows for our today. It is up to us to ensure that their dreams of peace and freedom for all are realized. We will now watch Wally Ferreira come up and light the light of remembrance, and Padre Bill Dodgen will open the service. Thank you.
Let us pray. Almighty God and everlasting Father, we come together today to remember those who have given their lives and made the ultimate sacrifice for those they loved. It is said in your word that greater love has no man than this, and that a man lay down his life for his friends. Father, we acknowledge that you have been our help in ages past, and you are our hope for years to come. We who yet remain are privileged and honored once again to say thank you, Lord, for your grace, your love, your mercy, and we ask your blessing on this, our Remembrance Day, in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
I'm going to ask Steve Prophet to come up and lead us in the singing of the opening hymn, We Have Come, Lord, to Remember, the words of which were written by another of our Rhodesian chaplains, Lieutenant Colonel the Reverend Bill Blakeway.
We have come, Lord, to remember those we love but see no more. Honored thoughts to Thee we render for their sacrifice of yore. To Thy gracious care and mercy we entrust, Lord, Lord Most High. Let them see Thee in Thy glory, know Thy presence ever high. Shadows deep have crossed our pathway, we have trembled in the storm. Clouds have gathered round so darkly that we could not see Thy form. Yet Thou, love, hast never left us in our grief so long to be. And the help we gave each other was the strength that came from Thee.
Good day to you, and may the Lord be with you. I'm proud to say I served in both the Rhodesian Light Infantry and the Rhodesian Corps of Engineers. I have two verses to read to you. from the Bible, and the first one will be Deuteronomy 20:1-4. When you go out to war against your enemies and see horses and chariots and an army larger than your own, you shall not be afraid of them, for the Lord your God is with you, who brought you up out of the land of Egypt. And when you draw near to the battle, the priest shall come forward and speak to the people, and shall say to them, Hear, O Israel, today you are drawing near for battle against your enemies. Let not your heart faint. Do not fear or panic, or be in dread of them. For the Lord your God, he is with you, and goes with you against your enemies to give you victory. And lastly, John 14, verse 2. And Jesus said, Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe in me as well. In my Father's house there are many mansions. If it were not for so, would I have told you that I'm going there to prepare a place for you. And lastly, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and welcome you into my presence, so that they also may be where I am. Amen.
Thank you, Alf. I'm now going to ask Padre Bill Beer to come up and deliver the sermon.
I speak in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. We gather today to pay tribute to those who paid the ultimate price, the ultimate sacrifice, those who answered the call when bidden, those who took one pace forward to defend their homeland, Rhodesia. Rhodesia called her sons and the daughters, and they responded without favour, steadfast in their commitment to the nation, its people, its freedom from tyranny, heedless of the risks that they would face. Today we commemorate in a special way the soul of those, our faithful comrades, who died and gave all that we might live, and that Rhodesia and her people might be free. The practice of commemorating those who have died and of offering prayers for them is an ancient rite. Judas Maccabeus, we read in Maccabeus of the Apocrypha, prayed for his fellows who had died in skirmishes, and it is explained that it would have been foolish and superfluous to have paid for the dead if he had not been expecting the falling to rise again. The inscriptions in the catacombs and the witness of the early fathers of the church show that it was common practice. Their memory is imprinted upon us and incorporated into our very lives. We can compare our lives to that of pilgrims here on earth. Our homeland is not here. Our journey here will continue, and in this lifetime we will always be searching for the true home. We will never quite know the mystery of life and death until we too die. The paradox of our life is that whilst we know we are going home one day, we must also be deeply rooted and involved in our present condition. Death also reminds us that it is this present moment that is precious. This is the only time we have, here and now, to do things well. To live my life wisely, as you must too, as though it were a precious gift. It is death which reminds us to forgive, to make peace, to be courageous, and to enjoy this time that we have with one another. It is through our relationships with one another, in our connectedness and the care of each other, of all life and all God's creation, that we become more like the God who created us. Our bodies may age with time, but our spirits may become more sensitive to the longing each of us has for God, so that the passing of years bring us closer to Him, until we reach that point at death when we are taken into His presence. For nothing can separate us from the love of God. We read in Paul's letter to the Romans, chapter 8, neither death nor life nor angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, or anything else in all creation, will be able to separate us from the true love of God that is in Christ our Lord. It is the final healing to which we will all be called. In the Revelation of John, we read, God shall wipe away all tears from the eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any pain, for all these former things are passed away. In the scripture of Thessalonians, which was one of Paul's earliest letters to the church in Thessalonica, he writes in chapter 4, Brothers and sisters, we do not want you to be uninformed about those who have died before us and those who sleep in death, so that you do not grieve like the rest who have no hope. So then, let us grieve with hope. Honour the memory of those brave and courageous comrades who feared naught, those who wait patiently, as do we, to be reunited with us in all eternity. Amen.
We're now going to ask Steve Prophet to come up and lead us in the singing of the second hymn, Amazing Grace.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found, was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that brought me here thus far, and grace I will believe. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. Through many dangers, toils and snares, I have already come. 'Tis grace have brought me here thus far, and grace will lead me home. When we been there 12,000 years, bright shining as the sun. It's no less grace to feel us grace than when we first began.
We're going to ask Marcus Main Bailey to come up and lead us in the turning of the pages and the reading of the names of some of the fallen.
British South Africa Police, Constable Justinos Maweri, Special Branch, killed in action the 29th of February 1976. He died in a vehicle ambush in the Hondi Valley, aged 26. Justinos, Sergeant Chatiza, and Constable Chikwakwa were travelling in a Land Rover near Pungwe Hotel, Penalonga, when a group of 12 terrorists opened fire, killing all three policemen. Patrol Officer Bruce McKay Baker, Uniform Branch, Team Alpha, killed in action on the 8th of February 1976. Bruce was killed in an ambush in the Nyamapanda area, aged 21. Bruce and Constable David Tavenga had gone into an area late one afternoon to interview what had been a reliable source, not knowing that the individual had joined the Zanla cause. He facilitated a terrorist ambush as the policemen left in their Land Rover, which resulted in both Baker and Tavenga perishing in a barrage of point-blank fire. Call signs from their base at Kotwa, led by Rob Tubbs, recovered their bodies and the vehicle later that night. A quick follow-up resulted in the elimination of the terrorists responsible. Rhodesian Army, Lance Corporal Jelly Christopher Aaron Moyo, Bronze Cross of Rhodesia, posthumous. Salute Scouts, killed in action on the 16th of April 1979. Jelly died from wounds received in action on Op Patel in Botswana. His BCR citation states that his patrol encountered a group of six terrorists, capturing four and killing one. The remaining tried to throw a grenade at Jelly, and with disregard for his own safety, Jelly tackled the terrorist, stabbed him to death with the bayonet. Jelly died of his injuries. Corporal Michael David Kilcoyne, Lawrence, Bronze Cross of Rhodesia, posthumous, Rhodesian Corps of Engineers, MDV Troop, killed in action on the 8th of April 1979. For a year, Michael was deployed on mine clearing duties, refusing to go on R&R. He personally found and accounted for 39 landmines, including 11 with dangerous electronic booby traps. He was ambushed 14 times, the last one being fatal. Rhodesian Air Force, Senior Air Craftsman Robert George Nelson, 7th Squadron, Chopper Tech, killed in action on the 18th of May 1977. An Alouette III helicopter manned by pilot Roger Watt and his tech Rob Nelson came under heavy small arms fire as they transitioned a hot landing zone. The helicopter took several hits, caught on fire, flames and smoke licked into the cabin. Disorientated and probably burning, Rob jumped out of the chopper and fell 300 feet to his death. Luckily, Roger got the aircraft on the ground, fleeing the wreckage with two trackers. Flight Lieutenant Bruce Ivan Colacott, 3 Squadron, killed in action on the 30th of May 1977. Bruce was killed taking off at Mapai, Mozambique, during Op Aztec in a Dakota R-73702. The aircraft was 10 feet off the ground when hit by small arms and an RPG-7 in the starboard engine. They landed after a violent swing and full port braking. By this time, the cockpit was on fire. Jerry Lynch, the co-pilot, couldn't move Bruce. He was already dead. Internal Affairs and Guard Force. Guard Lavros Magnani, Guard Force, killed in action on the 31st of May 1979. Lavros was killed in an ambush southeast of Chipinga. A Guard Force three-man mine patrol was ambushed by 18 to 20 terrorists, and in the initial firefight, Lavros was killed instantly and another guard wounded. A third guard, Mutomori, held them off for 15 minutes, after which the terrorists fled. Senior District Officer Ian Stewart Fife, Meritorious Conduct Medal, posthumous. Internal Affairs, killed in action on the 1st of July 1979. Ian was killed in the Nkai area, reacting to an attack on a bus. He and a few district assistants pursued the enemy. After reaching a forest line and making contact with 20 plus terrorists, he was killed by a well-placed RPD machine gun. Rhodesian population. Captain John Eric Courtney Hood, pilot of the Viscount Hanyani, shot down by Zipra terrorists using a Soviet SAM-7 missile on the 3rd of September 1978. The Hutchinson family, Dennis and Diana and their two young boys, Barry, 6 years old, and Vaughan, 3 years old, murdered on their farm in Lullapunzi on the 29th of December 1978. South African Air Force and the South African Police. Captain Paul Denzel Velleman, South African Air Force, killed in action on the 6th of September 1976. Killed when shot down by an RPG-7 in a Puma helicopter at Mapai in Mozambique. The Puma, call sign Hotel 4, was hit behind the pilot's seat causing it to crash and burn into flames. All on board perished. 9 of the dead were from the RLI, 5 from the Rhodesian Corps of Engineers, and the South African Air Force crew of 3. Constable Daniel Du Toit, South African Police, killed in action, 18th of July 1968. He died from gunshot wounds received in a combined Rhodesian SAP engagement with a large group of Zipra in a well-defended position in Ruamombwe Range near Kariba. He was part of the forward sweep when fired on from very close range.
Ladies and gentlemen, please may I ask you all to be upstanding for the last post, a minute's silence and reveille. Gentlemen with military headdress, please remember to salute during the last post and drop salute at the end of the last post. I'm now going to ask Colonel John Redfern to come up and conduct the laying of the forces' wreaths, which will be done in order. Thank you, Colonel Redfern.
Wreaths will now be laid on behalf of the Rhodesian population and the forces of Rhodesia. On behalf of the Rhodesian population, Mr. John Parsons. on behalf of the British South Africa Police, Mr. Derek Roche. On behalf of the Rhodesian Army, Lieutenant Colonel Terry Lever. On behalf of the Rhodesian Air Force, Wing Commander Bruce Harrison. On behalf of Internal Affairs, Mr. John Connolly. On behalf of the Guard Force, Senior Commandant Horst Schubersberger.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to invite Alan Strachan to come up and conduct the laying of the association wreaths.
The association wreaths will be handed out by Carol Doughty. The BSAP Regimental Association will be laying 7 wreaths. Pioneers, Jameson Raid, Boer War, First and Second World Wars, represented by John Sutton. Duty and Uniform, Town and District, represented by Derek Roush. CID, SB and GC, represented by John Pirrett. Police Reserve, represented by Neil Archer. African Police, represented by John Truman. Support Unit, represented by Dave Griffiths. Partu, represented by Athol Espant. Rhodesian African Rifles, represented by Rob Clemmer. Depot Rhodesia Regiment, represented by Mike Odendahl. The RLI Regimental Association will be laying 6 wreaths. The Rhodesian Light Infantry wreath will be laid by Rudy van Aert, Chairman of the RLI Regimental Association. One Commando, represented by Jannie van Wyk. Two Commando, represented by Louis Figueredo. Three Commando, represented by Charlie Warren, BCR. Support Commando, represented by Bucks Turon. Base Group, represented by Chris Rass. C Squadron, Special Air Services, represented by Roy Patterson, Secretary of the SAS Regimental Association. Sulu Scouts, represented by Willy van der Riet. Grey Scouts, represented by Alan Collier, South African representative of the Grey Scouts Regimental Association. Rhodesian Corps of Engineers, represented by Arthur Pollock.
Flanked by flag bearers Franz Pfeiffer and Bart Postuma, the former RSM of the Rhodesian Air Force, Ken Jackman, will lay a wreath for all 8 squadrons.
We're now going to invite Bruno Squera to come up and conduct the laying of the school wreaths, which will be conducted virtually. So you'll see the images of the various Rhodesian school wreaths appear in this segment.
Today, we are remembering and honoring all those that died serving Rhodesia. They were all members of various military band of brothers and sisters, but importantly, these brave men and women were also members of their school band of brothers and sisters. These were those that we were at school with, that we were educated with, that we played sports with, that we hung out with after school with, that we lived our youth with. In other words, ladies and gentlemen, those individuals that we grew up with, we are eternally bonded to them. We, the Rhodesian High Schools, thank the Rhodesian Forces Memorial Committee for the opportunity that they have given us to formally remember these individuals, not only as comrades in arms, but also as our brothers and sisters from school. Today, we have 29 Rhodesian high school and colleges that will lay virtual school wreaths with their roll of honor attached behind. At this point, I wish to specifically thank Adrian Haggard for having used the military rolls of honours, done an enormous amount of research and found out where these individuals actually went to school with. This has enabled us to actually create school-specific rolls of honours, and it's these rolls of honours that we've used during the past 4 years. What is very sad for me every year, as the school committee member on the Rhodesian Forces Memorial Committee group, looking through these rolls of honours, and every year without exception finding the names of individuals who I once knew but have only just discovered that they were killed in action or died while serving. Very sad indeed. I will now call out these school names. Alan Wilson, Chaplain, Churchill, Cranbourne, Ellis Robbins, Falcon, Fort Victoria, Founders, Gifford, Girls High Salisbury, Genifal, Hamilton, Jamison, Lord Malvern, Marindellas, Milton, Mount Pleasant, Northleigh, Oriel. Peterhouse. Plumtree. Prince Edward. Quickwick. Sonoya. St. George's. St. Stephen's. Thornhill. Amtali boys. Amtali girls. That concludes the reading of school rolls of honors. I thank you for joining us, and please take the time to read through these school rolls of honors. You will find too many names that you once knew. Thank you very much.
We're now going to ask Colonel the Reverend Bill Dodgen to come up and conduct us in the litany of remembrance, and followed by the closing blessing.
In the rising of the sun and in its going down, we will remember them. In the blowing of the wind and in the chill of winter, we will remember them. In the opening of buds and in the rebirth of spring, we will remember them. In the blueness of the sky and in the warmth of summer, we will remember them. In the rustling of the leaves and in the beauty of autumn, we will remember them. In the beginning of the year and when it ends, we will remember them. When we are weary and in need of strength, we will remember them. When we are lost and sick at heart, we will remember them. When the joys we yearn share, we will remember them. For those who have no known resting place, we will remember them. So long as we live, they too shall live, for they are now part of us as we remember them. In memory of our fallen, who gave their all and will remain with us forever, they shall not grow old as we who are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun and in the morning, we will remember them. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God our Heavenly Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit abide with each one of us now and forever. Amen.
Honoured guests, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for participating and watching this service today. We greatly appreciate the fact that you have done so. We look forward as well to being able to hold these services in person and physically in future, and we hope that those of you who are able will join us as we do so. Until then, go safely and God bless.
Oh, the whistling troopy's coming home again. The whistling troopy's on his way. You can hear him whistling even though he's down. He whistles all his blues away. Keep your spirits high, smile away the cloudy sky. Let the sunshine paint your golden day.